Meanwhile, more than 200 million people are on alert for heavy snow, ice, and dangerously low wind chills as the brutal Arctic blast continues to hit many parts of the U.S. 23 U.S. states from Louisiana to Maine were under weather advisories for snow and ice alone early Tuesday. At least 7 people are reported to have died as a result of the cold weather. Over 2,600 flights were canceled Monday, with airports in Denver, Dallas, Houston, and Chicago hit the hardest. Parts of Oklahoma, Arkansas, and Tennessee have been buried with up to 6 inches of snowfall. The National Weather Service warned that another blast of cold Arctic air is expected later this week. And finally, we go to the province of Alberta in Canada, where temperatures reached minus 40 degrees, the coldest Edmonton has experienced in more than 50 years, prompting authorities to issue an extreme cold warning for the city.
Bago po nga po kami pumunta dito, alam naman po namin na malamig talaga yung klima dito pagdating ng winter. So hindi na po yun lingid sa kalaman namin. Pero naninibago pa rin kasi first time pa namin dito at wala naman ito sa Pilipinas. Pero kayang-kaya naman po yung lamig. Kailangan mo lang talagang i-enjoy at i-embrace yung winter.
With authorities urging people to take necessary precautions, Philippine Consul General Zaldi Patron reminds Filipinos in Alberta not to underestimate this extreme weather condition.
Una-una, i-monitor yung weather situation. Encourage yung mga citizens not to go out anymore unless essential. Tapos make sure na kung magdadrive ng sasakyan, at least naka-plug no, doon sa tinatawag na black heater. Makiisa tayo, sumunod tayo doon sa advisory na binibigay ng ating local government.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
Qatar and France broker a new deal to allow more aid into Gaza. The new agreement will allow urgent medication to be delivered to dozens of Israeli hostages in the enclave. In return, civilians in Gaza will receive more humanitarian and medical supplies. The deliveries will leave Qatar for Egypt Wednesday night. Hamas seized about 240 people as hostages during its attack on southern Israel on October 7, which killed over 1,000 people. Israel responded with a devastating siege of Gaza, killing more than 24,000 to date. The U.S. says it does not expect strikes on Yemen's Houthi rebels to eliminate the threat posed by the group in the Red Sea. Speaking at the World Economic Forum in Davos, U.S. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan said it needs a global effort to deter Houthi attacks in the vital waterway.
We did not say when we launched our attacks, they're going to end once and for all. The Houthis will be fully deterred. We anticipated the Houthis would continue to try to hold this critical artery at risk. This goes way beyond being a regional challenge. This is a global challenge. We're talking about a vital artery of global commerce, a critical maritime choke point that's being held hostage, and countries and companies that have nothing to do with the Middle East whatsoever are being affected.
The U.S. military carried out a new strike in Yemen Tuesday. In response, Houthi rebels targeted an empty Malta-flagged ship, which resulted in a direct hit on the vessel. The ship was sailing from Vietnam to Israel with 24 crew on board, including 20 Ukrainians, 3 Filipinos, and 1 Georgian. No one was hurt in the attack. On the World Economic Forum in Davos, Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky urges the West to show a united front against Russian President Vladimir Putin. He also called on Western nations to step up their support for Kyiv to help ensure its victory in the war. Zelensky says hesitation in backing Ukraine could prolong the fighting for years. Russia's invasion of Ukraine will mark its second year in February.
In fact, Putin embodies war. We all know that he is the sole reason why various wars and conflicts persist and why all attempts to restore peace have failed and he will not change. He will not change. We must change. We all must change to the extent that the madness that resides in this man's head or any other aggressor's head will not prevail. Putin is a predator who is not satisfied with the frozen products. And we have to defend ourselves, our children, our houses, our lives. And we have to do it, and we can beat him on the ground.
As for Russian President Vladimir Putin, he warns Ukraine's statehood could suffer an irreparable blow if the war continues. He insists Russia will not be forced to walk away from its military gains in Ukraine. Putin also dismissed possible peace talks. Russia has said any negotiation would have to take account of what called new realities created by its forces on the ground. Tensions between the Philippines and China entering a new front. Beijing warning Manila not to play with fire after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. congratulated Taiwan's president-elect. As Zen Hernandez tells us, even China tells President Marcos to read more to better understand the Taiwan issue.
Taiwan's election results appeared to be a rebuke of China's claims as voters chose Lai Ching-te for president, who rejects a one-China policy. Lai is Taiwan's current vice president and candidate of the Democratic Progressive Party, which promotes Taiwanese nationalism and democracy. Global leaders congratulated the president-elect. Among them was President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Marcos said he is looking forward to close collaboration with Taiwan and strengthening mutual interests. Lai replied in less than 2 hours, saying that he deeply values the enduring friendship between Taiwan and the Philippines. He is also looking forward to enhancing economic and people-to-people ties while championing democracy, peace, and prosperity in the region. But this did not sit well with Beijing.
We solemnly tell the Philippines not to play with fire on the Taiwan issue, earnestly abide by the One China principle, and the communique on the establishment of diplomatic relations between China and the Philippines, immediately stop making wrong statements and actions on Taiwan-related issues, and stop sending any wrong signals to the Taiwan independent separatist forces. We recommend that President Marcos read more books to correctly understand the ins and outs of the Taiwan issue and draw correct conclusions.
The Chinese Foreign Ministry insisted Taiwan is part of China and that anyone who violates the One China policy is interfering with China's internal affairs and infringing on its sovereignty. It strongly deplored and opposed congratulatory statements for Taiwan, which it deemed as a violation of the said principle. China's embassy in Manila also confirmed Beijing has summoned the Philippine ambassador to express China's strong dissatisfaction and opposition to Marcos's message to Lai. China also warned the Philippines not to play with fire on the Taiwan issue and advised President Marcos to look into the history of the matter. But the Department of Foreign Affairs explained that the Philippines and Taiwan share mutual interests, especially with nearly 200,000 overseas Filipino workers in Taiwan. According to the DFA, the president was merely expressing gratitude for Taiwan's hosting of Filipinos while recognizing its successful democratic process. The Philippines also continues to recognize the One China policy, a commitment entered into by the Philippines and China in 1975. A security analyst sees nothing wrong with Marcos congratulating Taiwan's president-elect.
The mere fact that the president has thanked the president-elect in Taiwan, and there was a reaffirmation coming from the FA. There is no bias about that. We don't see any problem with that because we believe that we want peaceful resolutions of what is happening in the South End.
Another political analyst also supports the policy direction that the president is taking, especially since the Philippines has its own disputes with China.
Taiwan is not simply a repatriation issue of 200,000 Filipinos for several reasons. The number one reason is if China occupies Taiwan, it will dominate the region. It will have an easier time occupying the Philippines. It's very, very near.
The Manila Economic and Cultural Office, for its part, believes that OFWs remain safe in Taiwan, while assuring that it is ready to protect their welfare should China show more aggression.
We have a standing contingency plan, naka in place lahat dyan. And that is why one of the reasons that I came up with my recommendation to the president na kung maaari, wala mo nang changes of personnel in Taiwan.
Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines and Canada ramping up defense cooperation. Manila's Defense Chief Gilberto Teodoro says the two countries will soon sign a memorandum of understanding which aims to boost Manila's military capabilities. Cybersecurity cooperation also on the table.
Increased defense cooperation between countries, like the MOUs we have with other countries. They support our stand with the arbitral award, and they support our stand in the West Philippines. Yes, there will be.
Okay. Yeah. Have a name.
I hope soon. No, I can't give a timeline for it. Hopefully soon. Very soon.
Teodoro is also optimistic Manila's defense deal with Tokyo will be signed within the first quarter of the year. At present, the Philippines only has a similar agreement with the U.S. and Australia.